There are two kinds of sufferers in this world. Those who suffer from a lack of life and those who suffer from an overabundance of life. I've always found myself in the second category. When you come to think of it, almost all human behavior and activity is not essentially any different from animal behavior. The most advanced technologies and craftsmanship bring us, at best, up to the super chimpanzee level. Actually, the gap between, say, Plato or Nietzsche and the average human is greater than the gap between that chimpanzee and the average human. The realm of the real spirit, the true artist, the saint, the philosopher, is rarely achieved. Why so few? Why is world history and evolution not stories of progress, rather this endless and futile addition of zeros? No greater values have developed. Hell, the Greeks, 3,000 years ago, were just as advanced as we are. So what are these barriers that keep people from reaching anywhere near their real potential? The answer to that can be found in another question, and that's this. Which is the most universal human characteristic? Fear or laziness?
It was Hermes Trismegistus who said, "Bright and luminous as you are, O soul, by your own nature, you enter the world of darkness and engage in combat with it. And the world of darkness obscured your light and encompassed you with darkness and blinded you and made you lose sight of all that you had seen and forget all you had known. And in the end, you were captured and held prisoner."
There's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad.
I won't tell you you can save yourself, because you can't.
And it was John Bruner in the novel Judas who wrote, "We've been slaves to our tools since the first caveman made the first knife to help him get his supper. After that, there was no going back. And we built till our machines were 10 million times more powerful than ourselves. We gave ourselves cars when we might have learned to run. We made airplanes when we might have grown wings. And then the inevitable, we made a machine our god."
There is a storm on the horizon, a time of hardship and pain. This battle has been won, but the war against the machines rages on. Skynet's global network remains strong, but we will not quit until all of it is destroyed. This is John Connor. There is no fate, but what we make.
And those words certainly describe the stellar vision and existentialist anguish of the great Gnostic sage we will be discussing in this eternal now. Or more like his archon-killing work, kept hidden for decades, even from his family, but has now been finally published. Jesus on a corndog, we certainly need the breast milk of Sophia in these trying times of myriad false realities and the fragmentation of what is best in the human psyche.
What happened to us? What happened to the American dream? It came true! You're looking at it.
Mankind's been trying to kill each other off since the beginning of time. Now, we finally have the power to finish the job.
And that is Philip K. Dick and his Exegesis, a behemoth set of notes and essays where he attempted to fathom certain mystical and prophetic episodes of his too short of a life. I can't think of anyone hotter or cooler or just the right temperature as our astral guest, Erik Davies, author of Nomad Codes and a TechGnosis. Erik graced the virtual Alexandria on Aeon Byte number 193 to discuss his works and modern esoterica in general. Now he comes with Dick in his mouth since he was part of the editorial team that put together what might be the next modern Gnostic Bible alongside Carl Jung's The Red Book.
It's like God's vagina.
Ah, my beloved truth seekers, heresy shouldn't be this much fun but it just is. The truth will set you free. Probably break your heart and spine in the end as well. But you'll fly to heights and skyscraper levels of imagination never experienced before. And you'll touch the face of God with an open hand and tell him he shouldn't have taken that seventh day off and fixed his China-made matrix. I'm sure Philip K. Dick would agree.
The system's got more bugs than a bait store.
Slugs! He created slugs!
What a great show on this Saturday, March 3rd, the year of our Demiurge 2012. And there even won't be that much of my insufferable palaver, believe it or not. My newborn Evangeline, like the Matthew Sweet song, has brought great tidings from the realms of undivided consciousness. But she also has flipped her schedule and thus sleeps all day and rock and rolls all night. I'm so tired the walls are breathing, and that hasn't happened to me since I took acid in college. Also my health, and I won't tell you if it's mental or physical, is getting worse, to the point I'm becoming as useless as a vagina in a male modeling Christmas party.
No, shut up! I'm speaking rhetorically.
But worry not. What doesn't kill me only adds to what will kill me down the road and never really teaches anything anyway. And who am I? I am and I am Abraxas, that terrible god above god as the ancients knew him. I am the fiddler on the roof of your potential. I am the one who makes sure you don't allow the rulers of this age make you exchange hot ashes for trees, hot air for a cool breeze, cold comfort for change, and teach you heaven from hell, blue skies from pain, a green feel from a cold steel rail, a smile from a veil. Do you think you can tell?
We programmed this world so that no one in it could ever learn the truth, and you and Fuller did.
If hell had a spokesperson, I would carry her teleprompter. If Thor passed gas, I would be the one blaming it on Fenris Wolf. If Hera was on the rag, I would be her tampon.
Oh, God, I thought that was absolutely dreadful.
I am your servant and guide, just as you are that to me. And who are you? I think you know what comes next. Oh, and this is Aeon Byte Gnostic Radio, broadcast through the God Above God That Cam. Just in case you were thinking maybe you were having a brown acid flashback.
Oh, God. Did you eat all this acid?
That's right. Music!
We are the Gnostics, the lovers of the Esoterica and the Dionysian Freethinkers. We are the knowers of the unknown and the STDs on the genitals of intolerance, bigotry, and materialism. We are the lords of deconstruction, the revenge of the myth on our oppressors, and the word made in flesh, writing our own gospel and living our own myth, one fallen televangelist or mullah at a time.
Can't just go around doing whatever you feel like. You can't. There are rules in life.
Divided we stand, together we rise, storming the nirvanas of frozen angels and raging against heaven for our misplaced childhoods and paradise's loss. Are you ready to get this blasphemy started? Are you ready for Gnosis and your chicks for free? Then welcome with kindness and love, my beloved truth seekers. Welcome to the desert of the real. Welcome to the machine and the means to destroy it.
This is where we hold them! This is where we fight! This is where they die!
And certainly welcome Erik Davies, who will give us the dope on the almost legendary holy grail of Gnosis called the Exegesis. For more information on Erik, please visit his cool cyberpunk website, TechGnosis.com. That's TechGnosis. And certainly stick your head under the skirt of his sterling podcast, Expanding Mind. There's not much I can say about the great dick that I haven't said before in dozens and dozens of Aeon Byte shows. and anything I say you'll find in a superior level by his fans and scholars.
You are so mercifully free of the ravages of intelligence.
So I'll give you a snippet of the metaphysical Spanish fly you will consume in our interview with Erik. Philip K. Dick is undoubtedly one of the greatest Gnostic visionaries and literary mastodons in all of history. Much of what Dick wrote or accurately predicted was channeled by a series of disturbing mystic events in the early 70s. He received gnosis by various means from entities beyond sensible reality, and his celestial ideas still grip the imagination of the world and make Hollywood a lot of dough. Yet what Dick revealed in his books and notes was only a fraction of his visions and theological insights. He actually wrote thousands of pages that were kept away from the general public decades after his death, until now. And like I said, Erik was part of the editorial team, so he had a first-hand information of this Jehovah-shattering material.
Anyone who isn't dead or from another plane of existence would do well to cover their ears right about now.
In our interview, you will discover more secrets of the visible and invisible cosmos, and also realize that it will take years to properly decipher what is more than an arcane religious text, but living holy information itself that might free the spirit of humanity once and for all.
I'm going to show you a world without sin.
And not much else, my beloved true seekers. I'm about to pass out, and I'm sure there's a baby that needs a bottle and a dose of CC Music Factory to fall back asleep. I'll make sure you get the soiled diapers, O Ancient of Days, as a reminder of where you cast us once upon a mad god's dream. That place Philip K. Dick called the Black Iron Prison.
Unfortunately, no one can be told what the Matrix is. You have to see it for yourself.
In other words, enough of my drivel. Led us to Erik Davies and Philip K. Dick's exegesis as you get settled at Aeon Byte Gnostic Wadio. Or as the great Dick so well put, it is sometimes an appropriate response to reality to go insane. The Empire never ended. Hello and goodbye as always.
The future can change. Being written right now. But one thing I do know, I've seen the stars. I have seen the universe. I have seen the human race become vast and magnificent and endless. And I wish you could see it, Oswald. I wish you could see that too. Then you'd know how small you've made your life.
This is the Aeon Byte interview, and today we definitely have the pleasure of having back Erik Davies, who was part of the editorial team of the Philip K. Dick's Exegesis. How are you doing, Erik?
I'm doing excellent.
Well, thanks again. Thank you very much for coming on. And, I just have to ask you really quickly, can you tell us how you became part of this project, and do you still have a Woody?
Yeah, this was really, as they say, a dream come true. I mean, I read Dick when I was 19, and I wrote my senior thesis on him. So when I was 20 years old or so, I was a total fanboy. And if you had told me back then that I would have be able to work with this document, I just wouldn't have believed you. And it was, so I was definitely a happy scholar geek fanboy with this gig. I came about, I'm not sure, I must have been because I knew Jonathan Lethem and I was friends with a number of people who knew Pam Jackson, who was the editor. So I have a feeling when they were looking for someone to do the work of the annotations and sort of dealing with you know, getting annotators to read it and to, you know, offer comments and to kind of edit that stuff. My name must have just popped up, and it ended up working out pretty well because I could help Pam do some of the support stuff because she just had it. I mean, my God, like, you know, I just did a very small amount of really grindy stuff. And this woman, she basically read the whole thing. You know, she pretty much knew this. She had this room full of these Xeroxes and all these sticky notes and just piles of papers and, you know, somehow had this, you know, 10,000 page document kind of like mapped out in her head. And luckily I didn't have to do anything nearly as gruesome as that. But, you know, they had us, I did some transcription. So one, you know, it was a very interesting project on a kind of logistical level because, and, you know, in some ways disappointing in a way that we were all, you know, Jonathan and Pam and I and everybody were aware of, which is that it was a commercial process. This was part of a big package deal with the publisher HMH, and, you know, part of their deal was the Exegesis, which was sort of the lead off book to their whole reissuing of his back catalog.
But so before we go on, Eric, why did the Dick family change their mind? Were they jealous of Jung and the Red Book, or?
No, that's a very good question. I mean, obviously there's a real interesting parallel with the Red Book. You know, it's a sort of secret document that the family in a way is tossed this hot potato, and what are you going to do with it? And I don't think they were, I'm sure that in the discussions the Red Book came up, but I don't ascribe sort of like a desire for a mega hit necessarily on the part of the daughters and the estate in terms of this decision. I think that they had also been getting steady pressure for quite a while to reveal it, you know, not just from fans, but also from scholars. And I know Jonathan always thought it was a really good idea. So I think it just kind of made sense once they were talking about this whole new publishing deal. I'm not exactly sure how it came up in the course of those conversations about the whole reissuing of the back catalog. But because it was a commercial operation, there were certain restraints. They had a certain amount of money for it. They had and most importantly, a certain amount of time. So ideally, this would have been like this kind of, you know, very well-supported scholarly endeavor where you were able to have the entire thing transcribed. Then it would have to be checked and probably rechecked in order to catch all the error, or, you know, as many errors as you could. Then you would go through and edit it. Then you would, you know, that is sort of like the ideal version, which we could not do. It was just not going to happen that way. So the transcription was partial. You had different people reading different folders and pulling out sections that they thought would be good and transcribing them. And then they would go back through Pam and she would sort of edit it together. So it was a very hairy, difficult process, and one that inevitably has mistakes and flaw, things that were missed, and there's probably some, you know, mistranscriptions and things in it that was difficult because it's a very ornery object. I mean, you can't even really call it a document or a text. I mean, it's these crazy folders, and the folders aren't numbered in chronological order, and some chunks have different numbering systems.
Are they all handwritten?
Mostly handwritten. What he did is he started out, the first chunk of the Exegesis are all letters, so they're typed. And it's clearly he was writing to people about his 2374 mystical experience. And at some point he just kind of said, okay, I'm going to start this Exegesis thing, or I'm going to keep these letters separately as part of a process that was for him, not really for publication from what we can tell. And then he continued to write some entries, to type some entries, in 74 and 75. And then after that, it's mostly, almost all handwritten. But again, it's got different numbering systems, and just to try to put the whole thing into chronological order itself, it is a very hairy task that Pam did an excellent job of. But the robot the robot historians of the future will have plenty of work to do on this document.
Yeah, yeah, it's only begun. This is a living thing, a holy virus, which will, of course, expand. Yeah, it's funny because I remember when I interviewed Tessa Dick, she said that Phil would not even, she would often help him, she would type up, his work. He wouldn't let her near the exegesis and the paranoia. Yeah. So he started to wonder if she was a spy or an alien and all that. So it was very important to him.
Oh yeah, yeah, and it comes through, and you can tell that he did not think about it as something that would be published. Whether he thought of it was something that would be read later is hard to tell. I mean, he was messianic in some ways, and in other ways was a very kind of broken and depressive person. So it's hard to, it's not like he was full of like, someday people will find out that I was right about the structure of time. You get that voice once in a while, but it's usually a much more kind of obsessive, like philosophical, like trying to, get down to the kernel of the universe. And one sign of this is that the Tractatus that comes at the end of Valis, so when he publishes his fictionalized version of his 2374 experience, he includes in the end this sort of appendix, this kind of scripture that draws very heavily from themes and language and ideas that are in the exegesis. But the text itself is different. So when he came to write something that would be published that was very much exegesis-like material, he very consciously rewrote it and in a public frame, in a literary frame, and so much so that he then even quotes the published tractates in the exegesis a few times as quotes. So he was very aware of the difference between what he was doing and what would appear in his published work.
What I like is, although publicly he always said that he was a Christian and an Episcopalian, he does say in one point, and I feel validated, he says, I am a Gnostic. And he sounds terrified about it because he knows he's a knower of the unknown, and it's a great responsibility. And of course, then I get romantic and I go, once you find out, you don't have a long time to live. So.
Yeah. No, that's a very, for me, that was a very, one of the most meaningful passages of all that I read, because it comes very late. And there is a sense, partly because we know what's going to happen, but, to a certain extent, there's a sense of an ending in the last folders of the exegesis, and that appears there. And it's funny because the way he uses the term there, it's not about having like a Gnostic myth or a Gnostic model of the universe. At that point, it's really more about having a sensibility where you're constantly pulling the rug out from under every scenario, every model, every ideology, every mask that you confront in your search.
Yeah, but so, that's, the classic Gnostics, scholars are finding out, yeah, they were these skeptics when it comes down to it. They did not trust reality just like Philip K. Dick.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and it's not just that they didn't trust reality, because you can look at, if you look at this Nag Hammadi text and you pull out whatever, Apocryphon of John, and you go, okay, clearly this text represents a great distrust of the sort of, powers that determine ordinary reality, or, the world as we know it. Something that we find in all sorts of ways throughout antiquity. But in the old days, scholars would go, oh, that's because these guys are Sethians. They believe this. This is their system, and they write texts based on this system. And, that's probably true for some of these guys, but increasingly, it's like, wait a second, these guys were like interested in multiple versions of reality. And the fact that we don't know who put together the Nag Hammadi library. The idea that it was like one sect who was sort of collecting everybody else's texts too, or one monastery who was just, you know, wanted to just have a record of all this crazy heresy, it's just as likely to believe that it was a person or a group who were interested, like people like Phil Dick or you and me or most of the people listening to your show, in very different views of what might be going on, and who believe that the search was more important than any particular text. So even that multiple perspective thing that you find so obsessively in Dick and his approach to philosophical and mystical themes, it's arguable that there was a whole culture of similarly driven people in antiquity who knew something was up, who were very skeptical, suspicious about things, but they didn't think that even these revelations were necessarily pure answers.
Right. And I thought that line, and so did you. Can you tell us some things in the exegesis that really maybe blew you away, or strengthened a view you had, or changed a view you had on Dick?
Yeah, that's a very good one. One is that I have come, and I'm not sure how I would describe this feeling yet. I don't really have a position on it. I'm not sure, you know, for example, if I wrote about this, what exactly I would say. But the way in which he is a Christian has become more complex and rich for me. But not so much about, like, you know, oh, because he says he believes in Jesus in this part or whatever. And there's occasionally parts of it where you even get some of the kind of, like, nasty, judgmental Christian voice, you know, like that God will come with his army and destroy all the unbelievers. And
yeah,
you know,
he liked Yahweh.
Yeah, yeah, he could hang with the judgmental Yahweh for sure. But, you know, in a way, it's almost more an interesting question for two reasons. One, to look at it in terms of ancient Gnosticism, is the whole question of how you categorize Gnosticism versus categorizing early Christianity is, of course, incredibly complicated. And the answer is that it's sort of both, that you can't say there's the Christians over here and the Gnostics over there. It's much more complicated. And in a way, his own ambivalence, his multiple positions, in a way kind of recreate the matrix of that late antiquity, early Christianity mode, wherein positions that we would think of as Orthodox Christianity and positions that we would think of as very radical Gnostic dualism or Hermeticism are all kind of part of this matrix. And it's really the matrix that is being communicated. And so I think that's very interesting. But it also reflects something about our own moment, where even in our very relativistic age, where we're used to people having multiple perspectives, we're used to the contingency, there's no final source, whatever, it's still very important to us, whether we consider ourselves Christian or not, whether or not someone is or is not Christian. There's not usually a category of, well, he's sort of Christian. Well, she sort of believes that Jesus Christ died for our sins, and sort of doesn't. It's like, we don't really do that very much. You know, individuals don't do that very much. It's very important. If you say somebody has Christian elements in their work, you're like, well, yeah, but were they Christian? I mean, did they really believe? And it's like, and he does not let you answer that one way or the other. And that, to me, is like part of one of the things from reading the exegesis. I mean, there's tons of stuff that was great to come across, but that was one part. I mean, you gotta just acknowledge that a lot of it is just really tedious and sad and repetitive and, you know, mind numbing and dull.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And, you know, and you get, and there's part, you know, passages like this in the published version. So by and large, you know, the editors decided to get the pearls, as it were. But there's some parts in there that are there intentionally to kind of give a flavor for what a lot of the text is like. And some of it's kind of interesting to think about, you know, what does it mean to say someone's crazy or paranoid? And there are parts of it that are just flamingly paranoid. But what's more moving and difficult about it is the feelings in it, the affect. You know, there are places where you sense this, you know, very profound despair. And then this very exuberant mania for the new idea or the turn in his thought that's sort of exciting, but also after a while kind of difficult in its own way. And, you know, he had a very tortured emotional life, and that emotional life, you know, even though most of the exegesis is very abstract, you know, it's idea, 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 reference, reference, building a concept, building a system. You've heard it before. You've seen this one before. Beneath it, there's this very powerful and difficult kind of emotional thing that's going on. And then, you know, within the midst of that, there are clearings of extraordinary beauty, of spiritual serenity, of profound insight. You know, some of the more insightful, quote unquote, spiritual texts that I've read over the last few years have definitely come from the exegesis. So it's really like it rewards the long haul, because you really get an amazing sense of the different positions he had. And I look forward to the point, and it's, you know, probably not going to happen for a while yet. You know, the book came out in November, when, you know, people really sit down and they read that whole thing and they read it carefully and they think about it. And then what happens, then the questions that people ask, the kind of reactions people are going to have, I think are going to be really interesting.
So this is not all of his note.
No. The published abridgment in November is approximately 1/10 of the exegesis.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Wow.
There you go. So that's a 1,000-page volume is 1/10 of what he did. You know, and initially we had this whole fantasy of, like, you know, a 10-volume set or whatever, but it's never going to come out in a book form like that. Ideally, and we've spoken to the daughters, and, you know, particularly Jonathan, about it, that we make it available online. And, you know, if you could imagine having, like, all these texts just there, like, somehow transcribed, and then you just let it loose and let it, you know, people find their way through it and create their own pathways, their own sets of readings, and just turn it into, like, you know, it's like the three-dimensional holographic Bible in the Divine Invasion, you know, and in a way it's like that's the ideal form for the text.
Erik, did Dick have any new prophecies in the exegesis?
There was nothing on the order of the whole Tagore event that happens, you know, towards the end of his life, where he becomes convinced that there's the Savior in Sri Lanka, and then, you know, he gets involved with Benjamin Krem's sort of, or inspired by Benjamin Krem's movement, and he becomes kind of overtly prophetic. And he has a whole vision of the ecosystem as this kind of wounded Christ-like being, which is very interesting. I mean, he had a very kind of Gaian development towards the end that's pretty powerful in a sort of general prophetic sense. One interesting kind of mode, I mean, you know, what do we mean by prophecy? You know, is there's an explicit prophetic, you know, claim about what's around on the other side of the historical horizon, or there's sort of a general sense of prophecy, meaning a kind of deployment of the imagination in a quasi-historical way that sort of calls to task the current moment in history. And he very much does that at a number of points. Perhaps the most interesting thing along these lines, though, is one thing that we learned from the exegesis is that the Divine Invasion, you know, the second to last novel that he published, it emerges from a dream. He has a dream, you know, throughout the exegesis. He records his dreams, and I think nearly all of them are in the abridged edition. You know, Pam was very much looking for what's going to be the juiciest stuff for people, and the dreams and the voices in his head and the voices that he hears at 4 o'clock in the morning, which he sometimes calls the AI voice, are things that were definitely included in the abridgment. So he has this dream about the church being taken over by Satan, And, you know, in a way, it's a very Christian, paranoid kind of dream. And he starts to kind of unpack that. And as he unpacks that, you can tell he's actually starting to lay the kind of mythological groundwork for the divine invasion, which makes that book in a way, which is, I think, has a remarkable book in some ways and is very flawed in other ways and is not necessarily a satisfying read as a novel. But it has some great stuff in it. And reading what's going on in the backdrop kind of intensifies its prophetic character as well.
Did Dick go back to his other works looking for clues and say, aha, I just self-predicted myself again?
Yeah, that's one of the most interesting things about it, you know, especially from a kind of a literary perspective even, is I don't think we have, I mean, there's, you know, a couple things to say about it. One is I'm not really aware of any author who has generated as much self-exegesis as Dick did. I mean, he wrote extensively about his earlier works, like you say, you know, reading them for kind of codes almost, for almost hidden messages or prophetic anticipations of his latest idea or concept for what Valis was or what happened to him in 2374. So on the one hand, you have this very peculiar process of someone looking back at their rather significant corpus and kind of weaving it together for their own reasons at that point in their life, which is interesting just sort of in itself. But then he's reading them generally in, you know, what you might think of as a kind of, in a paranoid, not Kabbalistic isn't the right word, but a sort of decoding manner. You know, he's not reading them like, I see the great theme of The Man in the High Castle is, you know, the specificity of the object. And, you know, all these beautiful ideas, aesthetic ideas, philosophical ideas that are in his novels, that's not generally what he's doing. He's generally like, you know, this book was anticipation of the nature of reality, which is this construct that's run, you know, in God's mind, or it's a machine, or whatever his sort of vision is. And he kind of like, he sort of reduces in a lot of ways the complexity and richness of his own fiction, especially the kind of emotional, personal, interpersonal, sociological, like all the richness that's in his fiction along with the crazy ideas and the absurd philosophical scenarios. In a way, you kind of lose that. And what they become is sort of texts to be decoded in order to support his latest vision of how reality might be taken together. I mean, it's not always like that. I think the for me, one of the most powerful and beautiful parts of the exegesis, again, occurs towards the very end, where he has this almost poetic meditation once again on the sort of the fish symbol that initially triggered this whole series of experiences. Although in some ways reading the exegesis, it's not always clear exactly how much Dick was sort of narrating, building a story about his own experiences in a way that makes it hard to say what quote-unquote actually happened. But that aside, he meditates on the fish, on the pink light, and there's just a few phrases. It's almost a kind of poetic evocation of this event. And then immediately after that, he mentions two things. In the same citation, he mentions Togomi, the character in The Man in the High Castle, the Japanese bureaucrat who has this moment when he's in the park in San Francisco, and he looks at the small piece of jewelry, like the fish jewelry, and he looks at the way it glints and catches the light, and then he's transported into an alternate world, which is our world. So he remembers, in a way, this other moment that was in his own fiction of another kind of object reflecting light and inspiring a mystical state. And then he mentions Jacob Burma, who's, of course, this foundational theosophical thinker of early modernity. Burma had a tremendous influence that's only really being acknowledged now on the course of Western philosophy. His basic triadic dialectical mode was directly inspired Hegel and Hegel's dialectics. So there was some very powerful ways that Burma influenced not just esotericism in the modern world, but also philosophy. And the big story, you know, the kind of myth about Burma, about his great mystical experience, was that once again it was an object, a humble object, a pewter dish that reflected light that inspired or triggered his experience. So here at the end of the exegesis, Dick reflects on his own story of the mystical object that triggered his experience, and then he reflects on it in both the fiction that he produced that in some ways set him in motion, and this kind of myth in the real history of esotericism. And somewhere between, it's like if you could reflect, you know, the light between all three of those objects, you would get to the truth of the matter, you know?
Yeah, and you would also have to describe somebody's breasts. That's always in any book that he writes.
Well, you know, it's funny you should say that, my friend, because I mentioned, you know, the great, you know, the origin story of 2374 that's repeated in every popular account of Dick's fiction. I mean, writing about Phil Dick in the mainstream is also writing about his life and writing about his experiences. The two are necessarily intertwined in a way that's, you know, more true for him than a lot of authors. And then you know, the story of 2374, the woman comes to his door, he opens the door, she's got this fish necklace, he asks what it is. She says it's from the early Christians, and this sort of triggers this memory, and then all these experiences emerge from that. So he tells that story a couple times, only a couple times. I mean, he refers to the fish many times, but he actually kind of writes the story out a couple times earlier in the exegesis. And it's pretty clear the first time he describes it that it wasn't like, and you know, I may be, you know, this is just my reading, but my sense of it is the first time he tells the story is it's not like I was transfixed by the fish, which compelled me to explore the visionary realm. He was like, this chick is hot. I'm looking at her chest. I got to say something. What am I going to say? I'll ask her about the fish.
Yeah, I know.
And I really think that's what was going on. But in a way, that's also appropriate, kind of perfect.
Exactly. And what I find interesting beyond prophecy, Erik, is I don't think that Dick has caught up to our world because of his popularity. But I think our world has caught up to the Dick mentality. I mean, don't you think that you're in this day and age, you're nobody unless you have your own pet conspiracy theory like chemtrails, and we live in different realities, and stalking is not bad and paranoia is not bad. I mean, it seems we are more and more like Dick. Do you agree with this?
I very much believe in that. I mean, one of my challenges as sort of a kind of intellectual scholar guy, right, you know, writing about this stuff, is that I can analyze it and I can talk about literary history and I can talk about psychology and cognitive psychology and the history of religions and Eliade, blah, 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 blah. But on another level, I remain fascinated with his work because I think that it is actually prophetic. I don't know what that means, you know, when to say something is actually prophetic. And I don't just mean that he, you know, in some sort of literalistic way, you know, predicted our future, you know, and like a lot of science fiction you can go through, well, like who predicted the internet? Nobody really predicted the internet.
Wasn't Gibson?
He kind of mapped it, but I mean, at that point it was already sort of on the horizon. But even there, you know, you don't really get like anything like the sort of cultural implosion factor of this thing. But that's another topic. In any case, you can say, oh, this guy had Arthur C. Clarke had satellites and da da da. It's not really on that level. It's much more that he anticipated the kind of existential fabric of our experience. And in that way, it's prophetic, not in a predictive futurist way, in a literalistic way, but more in an old school biblical way. You know, what the prophet did was not like go, okay, this is exactly what's going to go down. There's some of that, but it's also that the depiction of the visionary world, the depiction of the trauma of history that's just around the bend is a way of kind of calling people out of their ordinary ways of going through the world and confronting like the real deep, the deeper implications of what's going down. And I think that's much more the way that he's a prophet. So including the paranoia, including the breakdown, including the multiplicity of views, including the mixture of humor and despair and lust and nobility and paranoia and just really capturing the sort of fabric. And there are these moments though of kind of this distinct, like, is he looking through the, you know, into a crystal ball or something? There's one part of the galactic pot healer, which is one of those, you know, not top 10 for a lot of people books, but I think is really great, even though it kind of falls apart. It's very interesting. It's the most Jungian of his novels. But it starts out with a guy in a cubicle. It's described as a cubicle, which I don't think was too common term in 1970 for the place of one's work. But he's at an office, and they have these pneumatic tubes where they're communicating. So he's all alone in his cubicle, communicating with the world through these pneumatic tubes. And instead of doing his job, he's playing a game. And he's playing a game with somebody else who's somewhere else by sending these messages back and forth through these pneumatic tubes. And they play this game of translating the name of a novel into another language and then translating it back into English and trying to figure out what the actual name is, which is so internet. I mean, that's so much more the internet than William Gibson's cyberspace.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, and just that takes three pages. Or the Penfield mood organ in Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? Now, we don't have a mood organ sitting on our breakfast tables to dial up our sensibility, our attitude towards the day. But if you look at the way that people use food, music, iPhones, psychoactive drugs, meditation, techniques, the way people think about their own moods is increasingly instrumental in the way that he was describing. So when you see that, it's like a fantastic allegory for a very real condition that we're experiencing in a way that I think is more true today in many ways. And often unfortunate. I mean, Phil Dick didn't want to live in a Phil Dick universe. You know, it's a rough ride.
Well, he would be right at home today, because another thing is he and the Gnostics were, again, skeptics about everything. And we live in the most skeptic times, don't you think? We don't trust anybody, not even our own minds anymore.
No, I was thinking about that the other day. We were talking about civic religion and how, you know, there wasn't that long ago when many, many, you know, lots of people in the United States had this sort of conscious or unconscious sense of the sort of identity of the nation as this kind of, you know, a light unto the world, as this kind of, you know, religious place. And they identified themselves, even if they didn't think about it in terms of religion, as Americans in this way that really felt like that kind of belief system that we associate with religions. And that's just gone. And it's not just gone amongst, you know, liberal progressive people who distrust, you know, understandably patriotism, but even the patriots, they're just paranoid. They're crazy. They don't buy it either. You know, they just have their own.
Paranoid is considered almost a good quality in people now.
You know, it's a badge of honor. You're doing your work. And, you know, and I have to say, this one I saw coming. I wrote a piece about television in the early 90s when I was, you know, I'd gotten online and I was interested in the internet. And I was writing a television column for the Village Voice, and I thought, I was just thinking about what's going to happen here. And, you know, cable TV was already, you know, had its many channels and blah, blah, blah. So I just started riffing on the, like, what was going to happen with the many channels. And I was like, it was very, very clear to me back then. It was like, this is going to, you know, there is not going to be a mainstream. There is not going to be the sort of commonality that, you know, broadcast television produced in the collective psyche of the nation, that we could refer to the same dumb TV shows and the same news broadcast, that was just going to go away. And when it went away, you were going to get tons of reality tunnels, in Robert Anton Wilson's phrase. You're going to get tons of conspiracies, of self-confirming feedback loops that draw people in, and the more people they draw in, the more real it is. And that's actually becomes an active program of reality. It's not just even a reflection or a story or a myth. It's like an actual sort of running machine of information, concept, language, of, you know, data feedback that sustains what we now have, are these myriad of reality worlds. And, you know, that's a pretty freaky situation.
Yeah, it's a freaky world. Again,
no, I struggle. So yeah, there's definitely a way in which, you know, I think acquainting yourself with his work is a way of initiating yourself more deeply into the conundrum, which may or may not be something you want to do.
Yeah, it's a path that, but again, like he talks about being a Gnostic, or when you are called as a Christian, you know that you're going up your own Golgotha. You either take heed or don't.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I've been thinking a lot about, you know, especially in terms of the Gnostic stuff that you cover so thoroughly on your show, that the kind of resonance between Dick and that ancient, that late antiquity moment, you know, one of his famous visions is that he looks out onto Orange County and he sees Rome, so that Rome is superimposed on Southern California circa 1974, and he didn't live that far away from Disneyland, so Disneyland somewhere there in his geographical imagination. And yet he sees himself in Rome, and he has this whole sense that there's this, he's in communication with this second century Christian named Thomas, and who kind of actually takes him over and, you know, drives the car for him. And, you know, some of it is very multiple personality stuff. But I keep coming back to this, like, well, why Rome? Why this moment? Why this obsession with the time of Acts? Because, of course, that's also what he does, is he thinks his most important sort of reading of his earlier work is his belief that Flow My Tears, the policeman said, is really about, it really takes place in the world of Acts, the book in the New Testament that follows the four Gospels and that tells the story of the apostles after Christ has taken the galactic space shuttle back to heaven. So there was something about this period that really resonated with him. And the more I kind of learn about that period, the more interesting the resonances become. Because up till, you know, earlier civilizations, if you think about the great, either if you think about very simple religions that we associate with hunter-gatherers, you know, simple in the sense not that they're not sophisticated, but that they're not bound up with incredible complex social forms like you see with early city-states like Babylon or whatever. But in both of these contexts, there's a sense of the cosmos as being a place, of a meaningful place, a place where you have your place, that you, the birds have their role, the stars have their role, and that in some sense it all fits together. And in a way, the job of the priest or the job of the shaman is to make sure that human culture and civilization reflects and tunes itself to this larger world. But then somewhere, you know, it's before Christ, but not that much before, you know, has something to do with Greek philosophy, has something to do with Jewish apocalypticism and the Jewish experience of exile is probably where it begins. But increasingly, you find the sense that the cosmos is a big drag, and that that sense of like holistic, you know, everything has its place, is a trap or a prison or a wheel, a grinding wheel of punishment. I mean, you can talk about this in terms of Indian stuff too, but I'll leave that aside. This great sense of suspicion, of skepticism, of no way, I'm not into this world. And it's, you know, in a way, it's an experience that's rooted in human mind. We can totally understand why any individual existentially would finally go, I'm not buying this. And at the same time, it also is very much about a certain phase of society, a certain phase of cultures, a certain phase of looking at the world. In a lot of ways, I think what happened to Dick is, for whatever reason, his reading was not that deep in this material. He read the Encyclopedia Britannica. He read the Encyclopedia of Philosophy. He knew, you know, he read Hans Jonas, and he knew some things, and he read the Bible. And, you know, it's hard to know exactly what he had his hands on or not, but it's not like he was a scholar digging into the nitty-gritty of, you know, Clement's, you know, comments on the heretics. And yet somehow he was able to kind of boot up the same sort of, you know, Gnostic computer where you're like recoding all the elements that you encounter in these sort of counter normative myths. So like,
William Blake or Grant Morrison have done.
Exactly. And so there's this way in which he was sort of really at home in that moment of kind of late and antique paranoia where you want to escape. And I think a lot of it has to do with the way in which he understood fate and understood determinism. And of course, you know, that's the big question, not just in Gnosticism, not just in Christianity, but in a way it's like the big thing that everybody's thinking about in the last few centuries of Rome is, what's the nature of fate and can you escape? What is the nature of necessity? Is necessity all? And if it's not, how do you avoid it? You know, whether it's conceived of as astrological determinism, where like the stars are controlling everything and the predictions based on astrology are totally true and there's nothing you can do about it, or whether the world itself is just, you know, a kind of organic machine that, you know, free will doesn't really exist, or is there some gap, some crack in the cosmos that lets some kind of freedom back in? And for a lot of those thinkers, this was a mythological problem, almost more than a philosophical one. You know, there's always some philosophers around, but it's much more hits people on the level of emotion, on the level of myth, of story. And in a way, Dick's stories and his thinking kind of reboot that problem in almost in those terms, so that he saw it as this black iron prison or as a kind of cybernetic machine. I mean, there's some very frightening parts of the exegesis where his paranoia gets very, I mean, it's sort of wrong to even describe it as paranoia because that's a way of keeping it apart from us. His description of the trap is so kind of insidious and psychologically real that it's disturbing. You start getting the sense of, you know, once you step away from the apparent surface reality of our world, then kind of all bets are off. I mean, where do you stop and feel like you've actually found the true story behind the mask? And once you see that's kind of an abyss, then it's a really, you know, it's a very difficult place to be. And sometimes he was in that place and articulating it very well. So it makes those, you know, stories, those Christian stories, those Gnostic stories, those Jewish apocalyptic stories, the stories about the Torah, they're all very relevant. They're all very resonant. And for me, those things are just as much a part of our moment as, you know, biotechnology and the internet and, you know, all these sort of modern, postmodern, you know, onward singularity kinds of technological cultural environments. For me, those, that moment of late antiquity is still very much with us.
Erik, it's interesting. I was talking to Jeff Kripo, your boss, one of your bosses, and I said, Jeff, Dick never figured out 2374 in his exegesis, so it seems like it was a waste of time. And it seems like all he did was go on a loop. And Jeff said, well, maybe he did figure it out. Maybe the reality is that we are all in a loop for eternity, and you have to, you know, accept it. You know, Joseph Campbell said, there's no meaning to life. Why should there be meaning? You know, in Eastern traditions and the Greeks, the universe was eternal and just recycled itself. But that's something our Western minds reject passionately. So I like Jeff's idea. Maybe that's it. It's that loop, that what his argument with God, that synthesis, antithesis, and thesis.
Yeah,
do you have another take? Do you think Dick figured it out?
No, I mean, I don't think he figured it out. I think he suffered the conundrum, and the reasons that he kept at it, the reasons he kept writing. You know, I mean, you got to remember. Okay, so here's this guy. I mean, he didn't write as much in the last eight, because we're talking about the last 8 years of his life. He didn't write as much, or didn't publish as much. He didn't write as much fiction or you know, essays in that period as he did in the 60s when he was incredibly, incredibly, incredibly prolific. Until you start thinking about the exegesis, until you start thinking about the fact that this guy was clearly staying up all night, many nights in a row, scribbling, 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 you know, pages and pages and pages at one sitting and in this obsessive manner. And so obviously there's a kind of obsession there. There might even be, you know, hypographia. Some people, you know, who are a more reductionist frame of mind say that what happened to Dick was a temporal lobe epilepsy, and it's clear that the temporal lobe epilepsy does have relationships in some cases with hyper-religiosity, and particularly hypographia, which is where you like write all the time like a maniac. So you can even pathologize him, and it fits into a sort of category in our reductive spaces. So there's clearly some kind of whatever, obsessive if not pathological aspect to his going round and round and round. And as I mentioned, it's really repetitive. And it's not repetitive in just like, oh, he just is saying the same thing over and over again. It's repetitive in the sense that he's like algorithmically running through possibilities, and he'll run through something, and then he'll get to a kind of end or a defeat or a double bind, and he can't get out of it. And then you can just see him go, but here's the idea. And he does that over and over and over again. But now I have it. And you're like, what do you mean? You've been doing this for years, man. You should know now that you don't have it, and you're not going to have it. You just keep running this machine over and over again with variation. And sometimes it goes interesting places. Sometimes it goes paranoid places. Sometimes it goes very depressing places. And a lot of time it's very repetitive. But it always starts out the same way. Now I have it. Here's the idea. And he rolls, and you can see his handwriting gets big, and he has a big exclamation point, and you're like, wow, what is that? And it's almost like he's like booting it up again. So there's this sense that the repetition is very much like it's iterative. It's like a machine that keeps going, you know, over and over again. And in a way, paranoia is a kind of machine. It's an engine for making connections and for building, you know, stories on top of these connections that you've made. So it's a connection machine in a way. And so you get that sense of it. In a way, you start going, well, maybe this is it, that he's actually modeling this looping process, this eternal return that
yeah,
we're
Nietzsche
stuck in.
And Uspensky. Yeah.
You know,
sometimes
exactly.
I think they're right. We're just round and round we go.
Sometimes I think they are right as well. And sometimes, there's a sort of, you know, kind of a kind of bleak gnosis that I occasionally contemplate where, you know, there is a kind of freedom, but the freedom comes only in this profound acceptance, not only of the determined course through a linear history, but to the sense that, in that Nietzschean sense, that it's just like this. Again and again, you're like, oh, it's going to drive me crazy. I got to get out of here. And you're like, yeah, but all you get is like a certain kind of like spiritual acceptance or some kind of like affirmation, an affirmation of this moment. That's what Nietzsche was on about, is that like all you get, your only way out is to just radically affirm your life in all of its mess and all of its confusion and all of its fear towards mortality and all of the same mistakes that you've made over and over again, the struggle, that sense. And in a way, that's the ethic you get out of reading Phil Dick. You don't get a sense of triumphalism, but you don't get a sense of utter disaster, even though they're often nightmarish worlds. They usually end with this sense of like people kind of like, well, we're only made out of dust, but we're not doing so bad after all, to paraphrase famous passage from Ubik. You know, and there's a sense of that that I think is very valuable, although it is, you know, a little bit challenging.
Well, I'm going to stick to my paranoia conspiracy theory that the demiurge took him out because he was getting too close to the secrets of the universe. But Erik, I think that's all the time we have today. I'd like to thank you very much for coming again on Aeon Byte and giving us a lot of Dick.
Yeah, I knew that. You know, there's no way to avoid it, man. I embrace the jokes. Hey, it was great to be here.
The green plastic watering can for a fake Chinese rubber plant.